God of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus, pay it all. All to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain. He washed in white and snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. And when before the throne thy sentence complete, I'll lay my trophies down, all down at Jesus' feet. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain. He washed it white as
I guess you have to be coordinated to put this thing on. Anyway, there you go. That'll work. I think I just dropped something here. All right, well, we'll find it. Good morning. Sorry for the confusion. Anyway, appreciate everyone being here today. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Have you ever thought about that? Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. In Colossians, what we're studying, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. You know, as I was thinking, as we're talking about having songs and doing songs in this class, do you remember the words of the songs or you remember the tunes? Or do the tunes bring back the words? If you look at songs that we sing to each other, we got some tremendous words that are very deep. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Is that a true statement? What is your all? Do you ask yourself that? What is my all? If I owe Jesus all, what is it that I owe? Is that a daily thought? Or is that a thought on Sundays, Wednesdays, or maybe once a month? That's what we want to talk about today, is what Jesus did. For the next couple of classes, we're going to talk about what Christ did. We're going to look at it in two different lights. Today, we're going to talk specifically about, adding on to what Todd said about the supremacy of Christ and who Christ was, but also what he did. Now, we all intellectually know what he did. But today I hope we talk about it not just intellectually, but a little bit emotionally. And no, I don't want us to cry or think about that. I want us to think about it with our heart, is what I'm talking about. Not with my mind, but my heart. Because what he did was unbelievable. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. We started with this last week, and I wanted to kind of build on this for the class this week. we talked about Colossians 1, 16 through 9, or 16 through 18, and it was, "For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him." Again in 18, "that in everything he might be preeminent." Now Todd talked about Jesus was from the beginning, right? In Genesis 1:26 it says, "Let us make man in our image." He read in John 1 where it says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." I thought I had it memorized, but I don't. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made. And then later on in the verse it says, "And the Word became flesh." So we know Jesus was in the beginning. That all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, thrones, dominions, rulers, and authorities, all things were created through him, by him, and for him. Why? That in everything he might be preeminent. We talked about, what does preeminent mean? What did Todd say it meant last week, or what are your thoughts on that? What does preeminent mean? First in everything. Anybody else? Superior, right? First in everything. We read that he was the firstborn. Creation, the firstborn of the dead. He is first. So to be first, first place, superior, surpasses all others. Is this true? Is it true? Of course it is, right? If it's true, and he's preeminent, he's first, and he surpasses everything and everything, is there an expectation for me? What should I do because of that? If you're in the midst of royalty, what do? Are there certain expectations? What happens when everybody goes and visits the queen or the king now? There's certain expectations, right? Because of his title, because of who he is, because of what he carries, what he represents. What do we owe Jesus? Submission, right? That's done out of what? Honor and respect, right? To be first, hold first place, superior. He deserves our honor, our praise, and our obedience, right? Our submission. Go ahead, Jack. He deserves our allegiance, expects us to obey him, and we're in it for the long haul, right? Is that representative of everybody? This is something that struck me. I've read these verses a lot in my life, and this struck me. Are we all created? Are we created beings? These are simple questions. They're not trick questions. Are you created? Have you ever thought about being created for him? I never had thought of that. I know I should obey him, I should submit to him, but I am created for him. If you're created for something, what does that tell you? Have a purpose. Amen. I have a purpose. Doris. Always a void if I try to ignore it, right? What's my purpose? If I was to ask you to take a piece of paper and write out what your purpose is because you were created for him, could you? Could you spell it out right now? Keith.
Ecclesiastes
Fear God and what?
Jesus.
Exactly. Beth.
We're here to be the praise of His glory.
Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. How do those two meet? I'm created for Him, for a purpose. Bob.
But He is preeminent. We have no other options. We need to honor and love and serve Him and His family.
If I'm created for Him, for His purpose, what happened? What happened to mankind? What did man do? Disobeyed, sinned, right? This is why Jesus did what He did. I'm sorry it's so small, and I'll try to read it, but I want to go through this verse because it's important, because I think it has a lot to do with what's going on in the world today, but also my life, of how I react, how I do things, my struggle, my conflict. Romans 1, 18 through 25. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their righteousness suppress the truth. For what man or what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For His invisible attributes, namely His eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world, in the things that have been made. So they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor Him as God or give thanks to Him, and they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools, and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. Therefore God gave them up in the lust of themselves, because they exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. What is wrath? What does He mean by the wrath of God? What is wrath? Anger, right? God's angry because of the unrighteousness and ungodliness of man. Bob. It is righteous anger. But why is He angry? What is it that causes it? Is it my life that I suppress the truth? It's because of the sin in my life I suppress the truth. Have you ever thought about that? Suppressing the truth? What is the truth? The truth is what? It specifically said it. Is God can be known. It's plain that you can see Him. His invisible attributes are clearly perceived by the things that have been made. Do we look around us and see what's been made and understand? Todd talked about last week the wonder of God. Do we explore that? Or are we just so caught up in our day-to-day that we forget the power that He has? He spoke what we see into existence. He's promised to be with me my entire life. Every step I take. What an encouragement. What power. Do I draw upon that power? Am I afraid? Jesus is with me. Jesus is with me. Yes.
He has charted the path and everything that is right to lead us to God. So there is no other path than the path in which He has charted for us that we have to follow, pleasing to God to avoid the wrath of God. He has set the plan in motion for us to follow. And He's come here and showed us how to follow that plan perfectly.
Amen. Any comments to that? That was wonderful. Thank you, Adam. Jesus, it says in here that it's because of Jesus that we can see God, right? We see his invisible attributes. Jesus is God. Todd talked about that last week. From the beginning, Jesus was equal with God. But have we ever thought about what's around us that supports what we have, but also in our mindset about what we've got and what we can attain and what we can grasp onto? That power is available to us today in our lives, in the walk that we have with Jesus. He is with us in everything. So this tells us that based upon what we have in our creation, we are what? Without excuse for suppressing the truth. And how does it say I suppress the truth? By what? Ungodliness and unrighteousness, by my sin, right? Have you ever thought about that? You, Tom, when I sin, I'm suppressing the truth. If I tell you something here today that's wrong, I'm suppressing the truth. Is it my truth? Whose truth is it? God's truth, right? Keith.
God angry. He doesn't like us sinning, but what really makes him mad is ignoring. If you ignore it, as mentioned in verse 20, you don't have an excuse. You're ignoring not just God as a spirit. You're ignoring the evidence.
Yeah, it talks about, like you said in verse 20, I know God, but I'm not honoring and praising him. I'm doing what you're saying. Exactly. And it says man has no excuse, right? Because it's plainly seen. It's
such were some of you. These are people in this particular spot that are being talked about who are either never going to know God because they don't want to, but they certainly haven't put on Christ in baptism. They're not attempting to live for Christ. So, but if I put on Christ in baptism and then I sin because I'm going to, whether I, you work for or not, what you're going to. I don't feel like that's me exchanging the truth of God. Because I know God, and I put Christ on in baptism. That's just me failing, missing the mark, but I get back up. I don't know that this necessarily applies to you.
When I think about that for me, let me just say for me, my personal thing, I look every day, or I think about every day, how is Tom living today? I'm a created being. Am I living for him? Have I made a plan for him? Can people see this, see God, see my respect for God, my honoring and praising God in every day and in every way of my life in each and every day? That's how I think it applies. We know that 1 John talks about if we walk in the light as he is in the light, the blood of Christ cleanses us from all our sin. So we understand that. But I have to realize, what am I representing? Who am I representing? I'm representing the creator of the world, my creator. How am I representing him? I was made for him. When I make my choices every day in life, who are they for? And in that little way, in that big way, am I suppressing the truth to the world that I go into? Because I choose to be like them and not like him. That's what I'm talking about. That's what I hope that we see. It says man is thinking he's wise. I know some people in the life, and Sue will probably tell you it's me. Ask me a question, I got the answer. There are people out there that have all the answers, right, to everything. Turn on the news. We got all the answers to everything. Man knows everything. I just look at when I was taking science in high school, how much it's changed now. We thought we knew everything then. I sat there, and from my second and third grade window, I could see the Saturn V rockets being tested by Morton Thiokol at NASA. I could see them. The building would shake. We thought we knew everything. We went to the moon. My grandfather used to bring out a slide rule when I'd show him my computer and go, went to the moon with this, because he was an engineer on the NASA project. He went to the moon with a slide rule. Anybody know how to use a slide rule? What's changed? But we think we're wise. And we, man, has started to worship himself. And again, I'm not saying anything about this here, but we've got to be careful that we're not doing it to ourselves, that I'm too important. God's important. God's the one. I don't want to exchange the truth for a lie. And God does, it says in this verse, gave them up. Does God give up on anybody? Is that what that means? It means he let it happen, right? He let me pursue my own lust. It was a choice that I made. I don't want to exchange the truth for a lie. And I don't want my family to see it in my life. I don't want my friends to see it. I want my coworkers to see it. I don't want the people that I come into contact with every day. I want them to know that I belong to him. You're going to say, what's a turkey picture doing up here, Tom? I mean, it's hunting season. Tuesday, not turkey season. You can see they're still alive. I was sitting out in my blind. I like to go out in my blind. I was there Tuesday morning. I get there about 45 minutes before light. I'm sitting there in the dark, all quiet, with my little window down, watching the world wake up. If you guys don't have a place like that, you can see the wonder that's there in hearing the sounds, seeing the world wake up, seeing the animals as they interact with one another. These turkeys were about 5 to 8 yards from me. Now, turkeys don't have a smell, they have sight. It's what they do to defend themselves. If you sit real still, and I'm in the dark in my blind, I've just got one window open. They're just walking all around me. I sit in an oak grove. Acorns were falling. I could hear it hit the top of the blind. And they're just walking all around me. And to watch them interact, those are three toms. They chase each other around. I want that nut. No, I'm getting that one. And just to watch it, God has such a sense of humor. How many people know why Todd brought this up last week? A spider doesn't stick to his own web. Isn't that wonder? You know, we're still not sure, man, still not sure why that is. I read up on it. I actually did research. I was like, that interests me. Why doesn't a spider? When you walk through the woods at night, you go, they're all over you by the time you get to your stand. But they don't stick to their web because they do two types of silk or two types of, and they have, I didn't know, hooks, three hooks on the bottom of their leg that they pick. They know where not to go. Isn't that interesting? I read up 36% of young people today don't want to have babies because they're scared about climate change. 60%, what I write down, 60% are worried about climate change, young people today, and 36% don't want to have babies because of climate change. I'm not here to argue about climate change or anything else. I'll just tell you, and my customers, when they bring it up, I use this as a spiritual moment. I say, I'm not worried about it. I don't know how the world's going to end. They're like, what? I said, yeah, read 1 Thessalonians 4. It's going to be a command shout. The Lord's going to come down, raise those that are dead, and then take me away. It's the way the earth's going to end. They're like, what? I'm in a spiritual conversation now. But that's the truth. I'm not worried about it. So what? Get a place like this where you can pray, where you can come close and be close to God, this is when I spend time of reflection about what I need to do. Where am I going? What's my purpose? The prayer, the time of reflection is needed. We all have a purpose. And if we're not thinking about it, we're ignoring our honoring God, and we're also ignoring what we're here for. Any thoughts or comments on this before I go on? Now we're going to get in our lesson. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased. We're going to be reading Colossians, should be 1, 19 through 22. For in him the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. And you, who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach. So, for in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. So in Jesus, the abundance of God was pleased to dwell. It was his pleasure, and it was the sum total of his essence, all of perfection, his powers and attributes were in Jesus. Now what he did, who Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. So we find that the fullness of God was in Jesus, but what did he do? What does it mean to empty yourself? What does it mean to empty yourself? Adam. Amen.
Bill. You stop thinking about what you want and you think about what God wants.
Laid aside equality with God. Let that sink in. What did he do? He laid aside equality with God. Wow. Why? Why? Amen. Because he loved us. He took the form of a servant. What does that mean? What's a servant? Helps people, Doris? So gave himself up to another's will. It's kind of what you're saying, right, Doris? A servant, a slave. We have God becoming a slave. Being found in human form. Adam alluded to it. What does that mean? What did he become? What did God become? Human, just like me, just like me. Doris.
Back to the beginning, when God made us in his image, and that that's what he's wanting us to be again, in his image.
Amen. Amen. He became a man just like me, and he humbled himself. What does that mean? When you humble yourself, what does that mean? Is it making yourself lower? Giving up pride. Again, supplanting my will for another's will, right? Becoming obedient. What does that mean?
God, but I'm here to experience something that God should not have to go through. That is beyond my comprehension.
Okay.
I think it's a reminder too that he obviously, that Jesus did not have any ego problem, which we see all the time in the world today. I mean, he could have easily said, "Hey, God, I'm not going to hang around with you guys. You can either do what I tell you or not." But he said, "If this is what it takes, I'll do it." And he wasn't worried about his appearance.
Amen. John.
The one thing I keep relating to the undercover boss, the whole idea, and he dwelt among us. You know, he became the undercover boss. He saw the good that some were doing. He saw the bad that some were doing. And he was doing it to improve our state of life. The only thing different is that the undercover boss got to go back to being the CEO. And actually, Jesus did too, if you actually kind of put in that thought pattern as well. But I do think that he humbled himself to see how it goes for us. And then learned what our problems were.
Maybell.
That God really wants from all of us, and that is obedience. If we can learn to obey as Jesus did, it will be much better, because God says he wants obedience rather than sacrifice. Even though Jesus did sacrifice a lot, he gave up everything to come here to show mankind how to be obedient to God. That was the Pharisees and Sadducees and scribes and priest problem. They wanted to obey man rather than God.
Doris?
Adding to that, he wants us to choose to be obedient. Because if we have no choice in whether or not we obey, it means nothing.
Is this a blueprint for our lives? Now, no, I'm not equal with God. Bob, go ahead and I'll do my thing.
This is that if we will do these things, we will empty ourselves of ourselves. If we take a role of a servant, humble ourselves, we become obedient. Yes, it blesses God, but on the other hand, I'm the recipient of all the glory that comes from doing it. My life is so much better. I have a joy that I can't get any other way, etc., etc. God does these things for our benefit, not for his, but for ours.
Eric.
I think he showed that when he became human, that it's possible for us to be tempted or things and still ascend one day to heaven. That's kind of what he showed us too, by being human, that it's possible for us to be like God.
Let Suzanne.
I think about it in terms of he gave up all the power and the ability to control the world. So when he came down as a human, we say, well, Jesus could do miracles, not innately of himself. The only way that he could do the miracles is because of his faith and trust and prayers that he made to God the Father. So
that's what he really emptied himself. He became completely human, that he couldn't do that stuff. He didn't have that same ability innately, but because, I was about to repeat myself, but that's how he humbled himself. But he could do the things he did because of how he had humbled himself and was obedient to God, and that God gave him that. God did it for him.
Or through
him.
God
did it for him since he asked.
Let this sink in. I try to get up every morning and look in the mirror and go, Jesus died for me. Can you believe it? I look at me and go, what in the world is he thinking? He died for you. Every single one of us in this room, he was equal with God and humbled himself and emptied himself of that and then became a servant or a slave, totally submitting his will to the will of God. And then he became like me. A man. Jesus, God died for me, but so did Jesus, the man. The struggles that had to be in his physical form. And then he was obedient. Is this a blueprint for Tom in his life? Is this something that through the strength that Jesus had from God, can Tom do the same thing? Can he empty himself, become a slave and a servant, become obedient, and then die to myself? Die to myself. Think about it. Wake up every day next week. Look in the mirror when you're getting ready for work and go, Jesus, God died for me. And through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. What does it mean to reconcile? You reconcile your checkbooks, or do you do that anymore? I never have. Sue does that, so she's a smart one in the family. So,
reconcile is to make sure that you hit the zero. Like I said, construction budgets, I can't close the project out until it's zero. Even if I got one penny that's uncounted for, it's unreconcilable, and you can't go to the next step. So we can't go to the next step without reconciliation.
Excellent. What does it mean? What in this sense? What does it mean, Jack?
I think to some degree it's to correct things. You know, it implies that if you got to reconcile, it means something isn't meshing. We need to do something so that it will come out correctly.
Was man ever in harmony with God? Yes, he was, wasn't he? It's the perfect state. And then what happened? We got in our own way, didn't we? We got in the way. Sin got in the way. What did Jesus do? He reconciled us. He brought us back to a state of harmony. A state of harmony with God. God came, he lived just like us, and he died to bring us back to a harmonious state with God. Doris. They wanted to be like God, didn't they? Yeah.
Yeah, they wanted to be like God. They listened to Satan, who convinced them to not to believe God. But in making that decision, they thought God was holding out something better.
Yeah, and going back to what Justin said, God, Jesus made peace through what? The blood of his cross. His death made peace. He brought our harmony, our ability to have harmony, back with God. In Ephesians 1:7, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. So in him we have redemption, deliverance, liberation, through his blood, for what? Our sins. Through Jesus, we have that. I can't tell you, I didn't count how many times it said, in him. In him, through him. Is there any other way to get back in harmony with God except through Jesus? There's no other way, right? It's not in me to do it. I can't do it. It's Jesus and the blood of his cross. And what does he do? He unites. It says to unite all things in him, in heaven and earth. Through Jesus, we're all united together as his sons and daughters, as his brothers and sisters, as his family. But to unite everything, all things, are united in Jesus. And you who were once alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds. What does it mean to be alienated? Separated. Not a part of it, right? I'm out, right? I'm shut out. I'm estranged, right? Estranged. Hostile in mind. If I'm hostile towards you, am I your friend? What am I? I'm your enemy, right? We're enemies of God. But what happened? What did he do? He reconciled us. He reconciled us. He brought the harmony back. It says, for while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Jesus is the only way. John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and what? Except through me, right? Jesus is the way. Jesus is the way back to God. That's what Jesus did for Tom. While we were weak, Jesus died for me. Again, I've said it before, but let that sink in. Grasp that. When we were doing the prison ministry, I told a story about a guy in New York, and I'm not going to tell the whole story, but essentially at the end, guy's walking around, he's got big plans in the city, he's got a job offer, he's got an interview and stuff like this, and he steps out in front of a car, and all of a sudden, he hears the brakes, and then all of a sudden, he feels himself lift off the ground. Here's wham! He turns around, not knowing what happened, and there's a man laying there that pushed him out of the way that got hit by the car. Now, that didn't happen to me. That's a made-up story, but that's what happened to us. Sin was bearing down on us, and what happened? Jesus pushed us out of the way and died for you. He died for me. If that story really happened to you, would you go in your interview at 10 o'clock? Would you say, thank you? Oh, I got to go see the Empire State Building now. How would you react? Because that's what happened. That's what he did. He pushed us out of the way of our own sin and our own... get emotional when I talk about this. But our own fate. He did it. Jesus God, Jesus the man, loved me so much that he died for me. While I was a sinner. Bob. Right. He didn't die of a stroke, right? He died a painful death. In studying this in the first lesson, do you know the Romans wouldn't even crucify a Roman citizen because it was so terrible? And Jesus went through that for me. Last part. He is now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death in order to present you holy, blameless, and above reproach before him. Again, he's brought us back in harmony with God to present us, to deliver us for the purpose of God, to put in place at God's disposal, to stand behind us and bring us near. He presents us through his death to God. How? Holy, set apart, blameless, without spot or faultless, above reproach, cannot be accused, and my sins can't be called into account. That's the lesson, but that's what Jesus did for each of us today. Let our lives show it as we live the next week. Thank you.